Welcome back to the Motion Hall. Quick reminder to please turn off your mobile ringers, but keep your mobile phones on so you can post using the hashtag DeMexico. Our next presenter believes that it's time for digital media companies to get smart, and they're leading by example. Vox Media builds smart brands that people love. The company owns and operates a portfolio of 8 brands, very influential brands that cover major consumer categories such as sports, food, tech, and news. Today, the company's chairman and CEO, Jim Bankoff, and VP Global Head of Brand Strategy and Marketing, Lindsay Nelson, and VP Global Revenue and Partnerships, Mike Hadges, will share how the company applies its winning formula to drive credibility, consideration, and conversions for brand partners. Please join me in welcoming Vox Media.
The New York Times once referred to Vox Media as a publishing house for the digital age. So what exactly does that look like?
SB Nation originally started because there was a fervent fan out in San Francisco who wanted better coverage of the Oakland A's, and he knew that he could do a better job than what was currently out there.
That fan was Tyler Blazinski, or as he's known to his fellow superfans, Blez. Blez founded SB Nation and sparked what would become Vox Media.
And spawned it into something that connected with fans so deeply that the idea, this concept of team blog, spread out to over 312 different blogs currently. We're adding another one this week, as a matter of fact.
From that spirited voice, we were able to build a company filled with passionate people who really wanted to talk about topics that they loved and bring the audience along with them. And that's something that we're still doing today.
Vox Media is a company full of some of the smartest media brands that are out there in the world today.
We are great at video, we're great at text, and we're really, really heavily built on voices. We hire really talented people, we give them big platforms, and we let them chase their passions without any reservation.
It is a place that is innovative and fast and full of the smartest people.
There's nothing that feels better than when we share something and people come back and said, wow, this really made me feel good. This made me feel something.
For an issue that's been front and center this election, there's a lot of disagreement about whether the wage gap even exists.
I still remember when, you know, I wasn't working at Vox and Vox came out, I was like, that's a great idea. Like, that's something new. It's authentic.
Vox Media's first major breakthrough was Chorus, the publishing platform that arms creators with the data and technology to tell meaningful stories in entirely new ways. It's what inspires our audiences and some of our most recognized voices.
Doing journalism on a bad publishing system is like coming to work with the flu. You might still be able to get your work done, but it's hard.
This is Ezra Klein. He left the Washington Post in 2014 to launch Vox Media's flagship editorial brand, Vox.com. It quickly became one of the most important voices in news media.
We came to Vox Media and we talked to a lot of possible partners because we had an editorial vision, but we didn't have particularly any specific competency to achieve the other parts of it. Best in class set of technological resources, of design expertise, of sales expertise. What we were able to do coming to Vox was merged with a place that really knew how to do those things.
Ezra's Vox.com is one of the 8 properties that Vox Media has built. And they're not just websites or social handles or events, though they are all of those things. They're fully fledged brands that live, well, everywhere. And through Vox Creative, the company's award-winning content studio, that same storytelling expertise is applied to help brand partners tell their stories too.
This is so edgy and non-traditional. You guys really couldn't have just set up like 2 chairs and we could just like, I mean, it's a little odd, don't you think?
Of course it is. It's the only way to tell stories that matter these days. That's what Vox Media understands. It's time to get smart with Vox Media.
Hey everybody, thanks for coming out. Julie, thanks for the introduction. It's great to be here. As Julie mentioned, I'm Jim Bankoff. I'm the chairman and CEO of Vox Media. It's our first time here at Demexco. Thank you for having us here. We're having a great time. Some of you may have seen me earlier. Today's my second time up on stage. First time was with Jim Cooper of Adweek and publicist media CEO Steve King earlier. We talked about the changing media environment, and hopefully it was informative for you as it was for me. One of my biggest takeaways from our sit down this morning, and something I've been thinking about a lot lately in today's world, is the unprecedented number of channels via which we can reach audiences, the new formats and the new technologies that are available to us, and the data capabilities that are at our fingertips. With all of this opportunity at Vox Media, we believe now is the time to get smart about storytelling. We use this at Vox Media, that's something that we're really fired up about, as you can see. We use the smartest storytelling to drive credibility, drive consideration, and drive conversion for our brand partners in a way that can't be matched. When you take a look at today's brand building environment, it's complex. Multiple storytelling platforms with ever-changing formats and best practices. There's data everywhere, but there's so little insight. Marketers are forced to sift through a cacophony of vendors and solutions. I walked through the halls of Demexco and I saw that cacophony in real life here. The far too frequent outcome is that brands are left chasing the trends of the day as opposed to engaging their consumers. It's too difficult for marketers to take full advantage of all the opportunities there are to tell great stories, stories that resonate, and stories that build lasting brand value. Many of our peers in the media creation business are guilty of contributing to this confusion. Or far worse, they lower the bar of quality digital content and storytelling. Too many modern content companies fail to put the consumer first in a cynical bid to get one more view, one more click. We're all familiar with these gimmicks: publishing clickbait video, reverse engineering algorithms, serving slow-loading ads that eat up mobile minutes. These things infuriate rather than delight audiences. Some of these methods might generate a few referrals or a few clicks to advertiser content. They may even net an occasional viral video. But to what end? They're fleeting tactics that leave audiences feeling unfulfilled and ultimately cheated. Audiences see through these cookie-cutter gimmicks and user-hostile tactics. And not only do they fail to improve brand affinity, but they often damage brand perception. It's leading to a trend that favors us as premium quality publishers because there's a flight to quality and a separation from bad advertising into good advertising. At Vox Media, we don't view emerging technologies as gimmicks or a threat to the way we do business. We see them as exciting opportunities to build deeper relationships with consumers. We also feel that now we've moved beyond the stage where it's simply enough to experiment and cross your fingers for a positive brand outcome. In short, it's time to get smart. Being smart has led to our growth as one of the largest multi-brand digital media companies in the world. And being smart is exactly what our approach can do for marketers looking to use storytelling to grow their brands. We believe it's time to get smart about using the full suite of video, design, and editorial capabilities to tell stories that build brands. To share one example of how we get smart with storytelling, I'd like to show you a quick video that was developed by Vox Media's flagship editorial brand, Vox.com. Vox.com explains the news and makes complex topics easier to understand, from politics to policy to entertainment and science. This is a piece that I think you'll really love, so check it out.
A few months ago, I took a road trip from Chicago down to New Orleans, and on the way back out, we were somewhere either in Tennessee or Missouri. I got pulled over. It's my first time getting pulled over, and it wasn't for speeding. It was because I was driving in the left lane.
So there are basically two types of drivers in the world. There are people who get really upset about all the people driving slowly in the left lane.
That's Joey. He fits in the first group.
And then there are a lot of drivers who have no idea that this is even a problem.
Yeah, that was me. Sorry about that. I don't drive much. The truth is, when drivers hang out on the left lane, it makes traffic worse and more dangerous for everybody involved. Here's what that looks like.
If you have relatively slow drivers scattered amongst the right and left lanes, faster drivers have to repeatedly slow down and weave back and forth, changing lanes many times to pass all of them. So if you're going 5 miles slower than everyone else and you're traveling the left lane, it forces them to make dangerous moves trying to pass you on the right, which is more likely to cause an accident.
But there's a better way for traffic to flow, and that's if we only use the left lane for passing.
If all the slower drivers are in the right lane, a faster driver can pass several at once, then get back over to the right, which cuts down on the total number of lane changes and eliminates the slowdowns.
Move over or get a ticket. That's the message from state troopers to people driving too slowly in the left lane.
Some people argue that as long as they're going the speed limit, they shouldn't have to move over. But there's evidence that slowing down and changing lanes is actually more dangerous than speeding. Research has shown that the strongest predictor of an accident is variance from the average speed of traffic. And a car going 5 miles per hour slower than the surrounding traffic has a greater chance of causing an accident than one going 5 miles per hour faster. That's why every state has some law on record that restricts the use of the left lane. In 29 states, any car that's moving slower than the surrounding speed of traffic should be in the right lane. And in 11 states, the laws are stricter. They say that the left lane is only for turning or passing.
Historically, police didn't really pay that much attention to slow left lane drivers. But more recently, there have been campaigns in places like Washington, Texas, and Ohio, where police are actually issuing tickets to people they spot traveling slowly in the left lane.
The reason why I stopped you is the law in the state of Washington is keep right except to pass.
This is something that has always been illegal and against the law here in Michigan, but now officers are rolling out this new education effort to help the public understand just what they can and they cannot do when it comes to this type of driving.
Now, it doesn't have to be this way.
A good example of this is the German Autobahn. So this is Germany's highway network, which has long stretches of road with no speed limits, and it has surprisingly low accident rates. One reason for this, some researchers think, is that German drivers are more likely to stay in the right lane for traveling and only use the left for passing.
That shared norm helps keep them safe. So, fellow drivers, I am sorry. I didn't know the rules, but I'm not alone. And if more people understand how this works, we will have much fewer traffic jams, and our roads will be a lot safer too.
All right. Well, I just want to start off by thanking those of you who decided to drive in the right lane on the Autobahn. And only pass on the left, remember that. So at Vox Media, we pride ourselves as the leading storytelling company that really invests in quality. And we do this across different types of content, from video to VR to 360, even text and podcasting. We do it across social and mobile platforms, and we do it at scale. In fact, we do it for hundreds of millions of people who enjoy the content on our websites, but not just them. We do it for about 500 million people who enjoy the content natively on key social platforms, Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat, even emerging platforms like Vine and Instagram as well. Any storytelling platform is where we want to be, and we want to be natively. We believe it's also time to be smart about reaching audiences in the real world. As we're convened today, we know the power of real-world interactions, and that's what we do at our events, whether it's hosting a music festival in New York City, like the Panorama Concert last month, or interviewing newsmakers like Elon Musk and Bill and Melinda Gates at our famous Code conferences in California. We also believe that it's time to get smart through powerful voices. You saw some of them up here, Kara Swisher, Neelai Patel, Liz Plank, Ezra Klein. These are people who are experts in their categories and expert in engaging audiences. And we believe it's time to get smart about reaching audiences internationally as well. And that's why we're here. In fact, 27% of our audience is international already. To date, we've accomplished this with very little internationally specific investment. That organic growth has been a big signal to us that we're ready to find opportunity to bring our smart brands, content, and advertising solutions outside the US and to better serve global audiences. We recently put into place a focus on international, and I'm pleased to introduce an executive who's been with us for a couple years who we recently asked to lead the international charge for us. Jonathan Hunt. He's sitting up here in the front row. I know some of you have met him already, and those of you who haven't, please reach out to him because we're really looking to begin our international partnerships in earnest. So audiences around the globe are drawn to all eight of our great owned and operated brands. They love how our brands, and you can see their logos up here, how they speak to their passion points with wit, clarity, and insight. So let me introduce you to each of the eight brands. SB Nation, which is our sports brand, appeals to passionate fans, capturing everything that they love about sports, from stats and analysis to the viral memes and GIFs that make sports so much fun. Vox, as you just saw with that awesome driving video, has quickly become the fastest news brand of the past 2 years, one of the fastest brands in all of media, by explaining the news. The Verge, as you see here, covers the future of society and culture through the lens of technology and the incessant change that technology brings on. Eater is the authoritative place to turn to if you care about food and dining and all food experiences. Polygon goes deep with stories about gaming, which today is the most powerful and popular form of entertainment that we have. Racked tells you what, where, and how to shop, with an emphasis on Facebook and social shopping, and also newsletters as well that tell you about the coolest sales. Curbed helps you love where you live by diving into real estate and home trends that happen on your block and around the world. Recode gives audiences a direct line to the most prominent thought leaders in technology and business. So these are our eight brands. They're unapologetically authentic, authoritative, and insightful in how they speak to our audience's passion points. Ultimately, what separates Vox Media from other digital-first brand media companies is that we believe in the power of brands. We don't simply add new sections of content or new categories like a portal would or a general website would. We build brands through authoritative understanding around topics that people are passionate about. Portals tend to dilute their authority. We invest in our authority. A starting point for how our brands approach smart storytelling is Chorus, our content management system that you learned a little about in the opening video. Chorus not only provides visually stunning and engaging ways for our editorial brands to serve content, it allows us to accurately predict the popularity of the content using data and really understanding deeply what our audiences are most interested in, the formats that they'll be interested in, and the platforms on which they prefer to consume it. This allows our eight editorial brands to respond to our audience's passions and curiosity with laser precision. But that same technology also allows our branded content and our brand partners to be smarter too. We take the best tools, the best capabilities and expertise that are honed in our newsrooms, and we make them available to our brand partners. Chorus for Advertisers takes the beautiful publishing capabilities that informs how we develop and distribute branded content, and it allows us to predict engagement, shareability of all of our videos and all of the branded content that we work with in the same way that we can predict the success of Vox.com or Eater Video. By making sure that our branded content capabilities also leverage the same capabilities that we've used to build our media brands, we've positioned Vox Creative, our branded content studio, to be far ahead of every other publisher's content studio. Through all of this, we've developed relationships with hundreds of millions of young, affluent audience members. Other media companies can't afford to buy or build these audiences. These are the relationships and the trust that create deep and measurable brand halos for the partners that we work with. As the media industry continues to evolve, the way that we reach audiences evolve as well. While many people are still coming to our websites and that number is growing, we're reaching more and more people off of our platforms, on social platforms, on mobile platforms, and we've truly become that omni-channel media company that is necessary for today's environment. So in a moment, I'm going to welcome on stage my colleague, our global head of brand strategy and marketing, Lindsay Nelson. But before Lindsay and I sit down and talk about some brand stories, I wanted to share with you another division of the company that we've made and give you an inside look at them. And think it helps you understand how we think about audiences wherever they are and how we produce the best content. This summer, we launched this division, which we call the Storytelling Studio, which is charged with doing exactly that, getting smart about how we produce our most high-impact storytelling and how we distribute it in a connected world. The Storytelling Studio sits between editorial, product, and revenue, all collaborating and dedicating themselves to telling the best stories in the best media for the user. It's made up of some of the most talented individual web natives that are out there in the market, and I'll let them speak about their work directly.
When Vox Media's producers, editors, and writers come to the Storytelling Studio, they lead with the format.
And the first thing they want to know is, like, how can I do 360 video with a little bit of VR mixed in, maybe some geolocations?
What we want them to do is take a step back and think about the story and think about the audience. We fit squarely in the center of when story, content, design merge in between our eight brands and Vox Creative. Why do you want someone to spend time out of their day with what you're creating? What makes me stop is a story that gives me context and relevance in my life. The more narrow and the more focused we can be, the sharper the voice is gonna be and the sharper the storytelling is gonna be. When Ezra Klein landed an interview with Hillary Rodham Clinton, Vox came to us and said, how can we take this to the next level?
And we pushed Ezra to do something in Ezra's style that was very unique for the audience.
The interview wasn't the story. The interview was the starting point to understand Hillary in a different way. And every part of that experience was carefully curated.
We designed it mobile first, and we designed a separate version that was tailored to the Facebook audience, a version for the Google AMP audience. We did an email newsletter that morning. Ezra did a podcast that was a different spin on it.
That story had over 1.5 million content views across all platforms. That's a win for us.
We used to approach a new story, we would really think about the desktop web. That has completely changed. Our audiences find us on different platforms and decide to follow us there because they know that we're going to be telling the best stories for them in those places. We have the best videographers doing Facebook Live on Facebook. We have the best producers doing Snapchat stories. We have the best writers composing tweets and live blogs for them.
We're really lucky at the Storytelling Studio because we're thinking about all these platforms. We can see how they connect and we can see how stories can be informed from one platform to another.
We do user testing. We use it to shape the content experience.
And what we learn, we take to the wider company, to Vox Creative, and to all our brands. It's not just the storytellers that need to think about storytelling, it's everyone. Essentially what it is a way to cut through the clutter and to speak to a person in a real way.
Why don't you join me up here? Thank you.
Other than that, I'm chasing you.
Yeah, come chase me, okay? It's nice to stop presenting and start talking, a little bit of conversation. So,
is this a job interview?
We'll see. No, you've got a job and you're doing
it.
Am
I getting fired?
You can interview me.
To be so public.
No. You can interview me. But I've been like cruising through the halls here, and there's a lot of talk about branded content, a lot of different technology vendors who are trying to solve one piece of the puzzle. Give me your perspective. You do this for a living every day. Like, what are some of the trends that we're seeing in branded content, and how do you organize to respond to those trends?
So it's funny, we were just in the speaker's lounge before coming in here, and I think you were doing the Adweek interview. And I hope this guy's not in the room, but if you are, great idea. And he's giving this pitch to the other guy at the table, and he's like, what do you do? And he said, oh, I've got this technology. And he's like, great, weird, we're at New Mexico, tell me about it. And he's like, it's brand storytelling at scale. He's like, we've got a way to programmatically serve stories at scale. And I was like, oh, that's so interesting, because we also have a technology that does that. And I think there are so many people who are sort of rushing into this space, making a lot of the same claims. And I think the challenge is that nobody knows where to stop and start. And I think there's so, because anytime there's something new in the marketing and advertising space, that also means that there's a business opportunity. And I think the challenge that the industry is facing right now is, how do brand marketers figure out where content fits into their overall marketing strategy? Who are the right partners? Because I think, you know, in the beginning, everybody just sort of worked with everybody because they were in a test and iterate mode. So I think we're starting to see some consolidation. The brands are going deeper with fewer partners. And I think finally, we're starting to see where the real competitive advantages are. Like, does it make sense to have your dashboard company and your distribution company and your content company and your partners and your creative agency? And so I think we're going to start seeing some of that shake out.
Well, you know, one of the capabilities, we just saw that video about the storytelling studio, and I know a lot of those people, and like I feel like always jazzed up about working with them, because they're always putting forward these, like, using technology to like just do this cool stuff, whether it's virtual reality with Michelle Obama or whatever it is. But okay, I can brag about it forever, but tell our audience here, like, why should they care? Like, if they manage a brand or work with advertisers, like, what does the storytelling studio matter to them?
I mean, I think for us, it's a philosophy of how we've organized, right? So most media companies have some sort of native advertising or content development capacity. And I think in a lot of businesses, that means they've essentially created a shadow organization, right? So if they have a newsroom, they have another newsroom. If they have a data team, they have a separate data team. If they have a technology team, it's a different technology team. So much so that I know sort of a major newspaper in the States that they had to literally duplicate code because there was this sort of separation between the business side and the editorial side. And I think we've developed the storytelling studio to be that place right in the center, to be that sort of institutional knowledge that helps both our brands and our brand studio understand how to tell stories in different ways. And what does that mean? Because that sounds really great. And what it actually means is the world is changing too fast for everybody to have an expertise on all platforms. So if someone wants to reach millennials who are particular fans of a sports team, you know, 3 years ago we might have said, okay, well, that's definitely a 3-minute video and then it's a 30-second video on Facebook. But now we have the opportunity to think through, what does that experience look like on Snapchat, and how do we bring that to life using bots or messaging apps? Because that's where you know, kids are interacting with their friends. And those are the types of challenges that the storytelling studio helps us solve. And I think ultimately that's what helps us be sort of on the bleeding edge of what's next, because we're constantly sort of critiquing ourselves in the way that we approach content development.
Being ready for change at every instant. Well, I wanna get into a particular case study and ask you some questions about it. It's about Infiniti, the car brand that we worked with. You led a big program to actually launch a new museum with Infiniti. And so let's view a video about that first, and then I got some questions for you.
Food is a hot trend, but it's oversaturated. So how does an auto brand find its own lane in a crowded space? You build one. Last year, Infiniti asked us to do 4 things. Develop a program that changes the way people think, feel, and connect to the culinary world. Create experiences across the country that evoke excitement and emotion through storytelling. Make the car the star of the program. And make that experience so amazing that audiences want to come back for more. So we opened the world's first pop-up food museum. To pull it off, we joined forces with the leading institution of culinary experts, the Museum of Food and Drink. For its first exhibition in New York City, the team pioneered the first public-facing smell synth and produced over 200,000 flavor tablets to give visitors a unique look at the flavor industry. And we didn't just park an Infiniti outside. Instead, we transformed a Q50 into an immersive amphitheater. At the push of a button, visitors launched into a first-person virtual reality experience as they traveled to different food meccas across the country. Over 10,000 people visited the MOFAD lab. 60% of them sat inside the Infiniti Q50, an unprecedented engagement rate. To continue the success, we went national and challenge chefs in 6 cities to create unique menus inspired by the senses.
Hope you guys enjoy it. Just have a blast. Have fun.
To bring MOFAD to an even larger audience, we launched an Infinity-owned digital destination, right where food obsessives learn about this stuff, On Eater. With over 60 original stories, from chef profiles to food science videos, we served content to millions of young food lovers Infinity aimed to reach. From concept to execution, we achieved success across Infinity's four benchmarks. But we didn't just build a campaign. We built a cultural institution. And most importantly, we built a lasting relationship between Infinity and the audiences that neither wanted to see end. MOFAD Lab was such a hit that Infinity came back for a second serving that will be even better, even bigger, even bolder than the first time around. Stay tuned for MOFAD 2.0, coming 2017.
That's really cool. Congratulations. I know we won some awards, but more importantly, we delivered for our clients to the point where they're coming back for more, as the video just said. The Eater crowd is a tough crowd. There are a lot of them. There are tens of millions of them, but they know their stuff. You can't just put up a video of a cool-looking donut and expect them to expect that to resonate. You know, that's fun and that's cool, but this is a much smarter program. Why do you think it was successful?
Look, I think ultimately when you're thinking about content as a way to build a relationship with your customer, your future customer, you're trying to have a conversation with them. And I think often what that actually translates to is brands just doing a single piece of content here and a single piece of content here and a social thing over here, but it's not actually pulled together. And I think what this really did well was we created a platform. It was a platform to have a conversation around food science that didn't exist. And it was also uniquely interesting, right? I mean, it's like that's where you have the easiest job, or I have the easiest job, is when you have something that people have been asking for. You know, the organization that was behind the Museum of Food and Drink had been sitting on this idea for years. This is a group of famous chefs in New York who really wanted to bring this to the people of New York. And Infinity was the enabler of that. But then they challenged us to say, okay, this is great. We don't want to have a sponsorship, you know, opportunity here. We don't want to just put our logo on the door. How do we be part of the experience but not feel sort of awkwardly on the side? And that's where I actually really respect the client, because we didn't really have the answer up front on what to do with a car in a very small space that was like half the size of this room. And how do you put a car in the middle of a room and not make it feel like, you know, you're at a dealership? And it's not easy. And when we proposed a bunch of ideas, and that they shot them down, they kept pushing us to say, make this a content experience in and of itself. And our first idea, which I still think is a good one, was we wanted to make the entire car scratch and sniff.
Huh.
Which is possible, apparently, but they didn't love the idea. We wanted to do really bizarre.
All right. Well, you know, I'm glad that it all worked out in the end, though.
Right? It'd be a great photo opportunity. But we then came up with this idea of actually transforming the car, which is a really intimate space that sort of can create this notion of virtual reality. You're in an enclosed environment. We blacked out the windows. It has an amazing sound system. And we projection mapped on top of the screen these first-person videos that we shot actually driving to a famous restaurant that took you through the front door into the kitchen and you watched a dish being made. And it was really amazing. I mean, and 60% of people to get into a car without you giving them like a gift card or like a, you know, a free smoothie or something.
No, it's real. And you know, that audience is big. It's also valuable people who have jobs, who have disposable income, who like to go out and spend that money and have a good time.
And those are smart people, right? You can't like fool them. You can't give them crappy content and sort of try and masquerade it as something interesting when you're talking to a sophisticated audience that reads high quality journalism, that expects, you know, high quality experiences, and their time is valuable.
So we're proud of the brands that we manage, but I know that partnership is a big part of how we get in front of other audiences. You know, we might have, you know, several hundred million people that we touch, but our goal is to operate at even greater scale, like true global scale, true saturation in terms for the marketers that want that. We recently struck a deal with NBC Universal as one of those big content partners. It's been a great partnership from my perspective. They invested in our company and have a minority stake. But beyond the investment, there's been a lot of collaboration. Tell me a little bit about that from your perspective. I know you're on the front lines of bringing solutions to clients with NBC.
Right. I mean, when we did the partnership with NBC Universal, I was so excited because I think you finally have this opportunity to merge what you can do with the scale and impact of television with the agility and innovation that you see in the digital space. And that's really the complaint in the industry right now, is that why are those two worlds so far apart? And I want to spend my money and invest my marketing dollars in both of those, but they're not coming together. And I think this is really the first time, at least in the US market, that those worlds have come together. And with a single activation, you can combine their intellectual property with our intellectual property, merge a brand with both of those, and do a content experience that is going to get just unrivaled reach, because you can't match both our digital audiences combined plus, you know, the power of television.
Yeah, I think I mentioned briefly when I was talking about this flight to quality, and you know, we're excited to partner with NBC, other premium publishers as well. Let's face it, a lot of online advertising just sucks as a consumer. The formats suck, there are pop-ups, or there are things that I mentioned, burn through your mobile minutes, they annoy you rather than delight you. The creative has to be good, as we've seen. The formats have to be good, and the context still matters too. You want to be in front of audiences that are there to see great brands like ours, like NBC Universal's, like the other partners that we have. So we don't just restrain it or constrain it to our reach. We look for partners that can do that as well. So you're the expert. Yeah, you are.
Nice.
What's next? I mean, we've heard a little bit about what we're up to now, but what kind of innovation can the industry expect when we're here next year? What are people going to be talking about?
You know, I think we're in a world where, you know, you touched on quality, where I think brands are starting to say, like, I don't have a content problem. Like, I don't need more content. That's not the game I'm playing. I'm trying to move culture. I'm trying to build relationships and connections. And I think once you shift your attitude, you also start thinking about results a little bit differently. And I think, you know, for the last couple years, it was all about scale, and it was all about the most number, you know, the biggest number of eyeballs possible on a piece of content. And I think we're going to evolve into a place where, for some brands, that's still going to be the case when there's, you know, brands that sort of advertise to everybody. But I think for others, we're going to start seeing, you know, sort of a priority around re-engagement.
What does that mean?
Around if you are Jim Bankoff, as you are, and I am, you know, Goldman Sachs, because I think you have some, a big future in front of you, hopefully. And I think I want to sell you on my private wealth management services or my retirement services. Me putting a single piece of content in front of you once is not going to do that. It's not going to make any impact at all in how you feel about trusting my company versus the other seven guys that are advertising to you. And so I think if we can build the data and technology infrastructure, which we've started to do, and I think we're pretty much there, to be able to have a conversation with you over time. So that might mean every Monday.
That's interesting.
We're in your
inbox. I think, you know, there's been this spray and pray mentality to branded content. Like, let's put it out there and hope for the viral hit. And we usually don't get one, but every once in a while we do. We walk into our boss's office and say, we got the viral hit. And that was good a couple of years ago, but now you're kind of asking yourself, like, did it have any impact on our brand, on our business? Was it just completely empty calories,
right,
or did it provide any nutritional value? And I think what you're talking about is being smart about all elements of the funnel, the marketing funnel, and how we connect brand building with purchase intent with the ultimate conversion.
Totally, because I think often it's so easy and so romantic to have these conversations about creativity, and I am a creative at heart. I'm like a creative who's now kind of a suit, so in a nice dress, hopefully.
Yeah.
And I think you can't forget that marketers oftentimes, especially those that work for public companies, are having to post results. They're having to justify their investment, and that doesn't stop with content in the same way that they look at their other media mix. And so I think if we can move those worlds closer together through data, through a deeper understanding of what their return on investment looks like, while also still telling really incredible stories that actually change people's hearts and minds, I think that's the bright future of content marketing if we can get it right.
Okay, well, you just spoke of incredible stories. I wanna show one here. I think we're doing a project right now with Russell Athletics. You led it. It's about a high school football team that lost the championship by one point. I want to show it. You want to tee it up for us?
So this was in my inbox like 2 weeks ago, and I'm obsessed with it because I think it's a perfect example of how to do it right. And I think I love this example because it gets to the ethos of what Russell Athletics is all about. So Russell Athletics claims that they invented the sweatshirt. And for those of you who live in the U.S., it's like if you're a junior high or high school athlete, it's like your team T-shirts are always Russell Athletics. And this is a program where we went and we visited high school football teams that had just barely lost a championship game.
Okay, and before we play it, we're gonna walk off stage. When the video ends, Mike Hodges, who runs revenue for us, is gonna talk to you a little bit more about exactly how we can activate all these stories and make sure that they reach the right audience. So let's see this cool campaign.
We're Lummi. We're part of the Coast Salish homeland.
We are people of the sea.
The Lummi Nation is family, love, strong. We're all together.
If you look back at our history, we've lost a lot.
I think the Lord just drew me here because I could make some type of impact, and it would be long lasting.
Coach, we call him Sandman.
I really love Sandman. Can you tell? Oh, well. He respects our traditional ways.
I'll have that phone number for the rest of my life. You get in trouble, you give me a call.
I grew up without a dad, so I look more at him as a dad. He's there for me. He's just there for me.
When Lummi Nation started football in 2002, they had no place to play. And they come to me and asked if they could play on my field. And so they played their first football season on technically on my backyard.
Lummi Nation rally around football because they love to support the youth.
Last year at the Dome was crazy. It was loud.
We had a lot to be proud of and to celebrate.
We rallied back after we took the lead, and at that point, I'm running down going, yeah, this is it. We got it. And looked back on the field, and we had a holding call. Called our bread and butter play, and just weren't able to execute it.
Well, it was disappointing.
It was heartbreaking. You know, anything in life will have its challenges, but it's what you do with it.
One play that happened that haunts us, but we're one team, one nation, and we're ready to get back on top.
Ready!
We were an 8-man squad that played like 11.
And yet, we still fell. Just one play separated us from our championship dreams.
Now one play fuels Black Hawk Nation.
One play is the symbol to drive us back to where we belong.
This shirt is our constant reminder
to never let one play decide our destiny. People are watching, and they're a reflection of their community. Go. I hear it all the time. I'm going to be a Blackhawk when I get big.
Come together as one unit, one team, one family.
Who are we? Blackhawks!
Lifelong friendships, playing football together.
That's some really good content that we did for Russell. As Jim mentioned and Lindsay mentioned, my name is Mike Hodges. I run global revenue and partnerships here at Vox Media. As you just saw, and as Jim just talked about, and Lindsay just talked about, we make some amazing content that we do for our clients, but none of this would happen, or any of you guys would not see this, if we can't get an audience for that content. So I'd like to talk a little bit more about how our beautiful ads and technology we use to get this content that you just saw out to a wide audience. So in today's digital landscape, we keep hearing all the negativity about digital advertising. Basically, Jim mentioned it earlier, digital ads, they just suck. That's what we hear. They have poor viewability, plagued by ad fraud, bot traffic, all working together to drive down performance. So this makes storytelling at scale very difficult. My focus over the last past few years was how we create a smart distribution channel for the incredible storytelling we're doing at Vox Creative for our advertisers. At Vox Media, we believe ads perform their best when they're in a premium environment. We aren't the only ones that think that. Earlier this year, Comscore released a study with the Digital Content Next, the DCN, that proved that premium publishers drive a higher ad effectiveness than non-premium publishers. Vox Media was one of the publishers in this study. What happened was the results were ads that were shown on a premium website performed 67% better than the same exact ads shown on a non-premium website. Even more, premium publishers saw 3 times more efficient rate for driving mid-funnel activity. Basically, smart ads around smart content perform. While the rest of the industry has been focused on standard ads, we at Vox Media have been obsessed over creating ads that work. Again, basically ads that don't suck. So we built our own. What have the results been? Our smart ads perform 15 times above the industry average. They don't just work, they work at scale. They are unique ads. These unique ads are successful because they carry trusted content, they provide the best user experience, they offer the most beautiful performance on any screen, and they attract the most engaged audiences. An area that we've particularly focused on is creating ad units where audiences love to consume video. If you've walked around DMexico this week, I'm pretty much you've heard people love consuming video. We created an ad unit we call the immersive unit. This combines dynamic video with bold, beautiful creative. Videos viewed in this unit have a 61% intention rate. That's very high for a banner ad. Producing high level of user engagement, the universal touch rate is 362% higher than the industry benchmarks. And then even more impressive is that video views in this unit have a completion rate upwards of 80%. Now think about that stat for a second. These stats are coming from video units that a user has to engage with first. They have to press start. They have to sit there and watch. This is not an autoplay unit. Again, we're focusing on smart creative with smart ads coupled with smart distribution to help drive performance and engagements to make campaigns perform. So I want to give a quick example of 2 new smart ad units that we're coming out with today. The first is a format called Panoramic. It's a multi-dimensional creative that allows people to engage with your brand by tilting the phone. So think of VR, 360 video, how that is now becoming a thing. We've created an ad unit that allows a user to experience and respond to their curiosities that is seamless and that is beautiful and completely engaging. In so many ways, this unit represents the way Vox Media thinks about advertising. It appeals to an audience, and it does not get in the way of what they're trying to consume. It integrates seamlessly across our content as well as our partners' content. Another, continuing our growth on innovation, we've come out with another ad that I'm sure you all have heard this format with vertical video. Vertical video has been widely accepted right now in the mobile ad space. Consumers are spending more and more time on their vertical screen. Last year, mobile users spent about 150 minutes per day on a vertical screen. Think about it yourself right now. Those are probably have it in your phone buried. You're vertical right now. You're tweeting. You're looking at Snapchat. This is a format that's not going away. You want to invest in this format. So we're really excited today to announce that we are launching a vertical video format that will not only work across the 8 brands at Vox Media, but also our partners as well. We believe that ads perform their best, as we've talked about, when you have a smart creative campaign, you couple it with the smart ad units that I just talked about, you surround it with smart content. But if you don't have any scale, how would anyone know how smart you are? Now it's time to get smart about distribution. So we forged a partnership, as Lindsay and Jim talked about, with NBCU to create an audience network called Concert. It's the largest premium quality content and audience marketplace available to advertisers. Concert is a pairing of Vox Media's smart ads that I just talked about with premium content. We've enabled our advertisers to reach high-value audiences with true brand storytelling at scale. And our mission is enhanced with the user experience that we've created, and not detract from the fact that they are looking at the content on the website that they're on. A nicer way of don't make ads that suck. So what does this mean? How's the scale? So with Concert, we already are at the scale of, say, Yahoo, but with a much more appealing audience profile and a demographic that you're all trying to reach. Our scale is massive. When you look at it globally, it's 150 million unduplicated uniques within ComScore. When you pare it down to just here in this audience in the European region, that's about 34 million uniques in ComScore. And then the buzzword that everyone hates, and Jim declared earlier today on stage, that is one of the most annoying buzzwords, we reach about 82% of all millennials online. So with Concert, we developed over 20 ad formats that are mobile first, focus on content, video, and high impact, and for social distribution. These formats leverage creative optimization and sophisticated targeting to deliver the right format at the right time to the right user. And what we've seen from our performance, as we show here, we've seen a 15x lift in engagement for standard ads. The performance we've seen for these videos, or for the videos for Concert, as we talked about, have about almost upwards of 82% video completion rate within the Concert ad unit. Again, all user initiated, which is huge. When it comes to video distribution, that moves the needle, and Vox Media helps you be best in class. We have about 40 brands since we've launched Concert earlier this year that have taken advantage of this massive scale and beautiful ads and trusted content that we've created. Earlier today, Jim has talked about how Vox Media takes the best capabilities, expertise, and insights and makes them available to our partners. As you heard throughout this presentation, we are obsessed with making marketers extremely smart with their ad campaigns at scale. We do this by relying on our new exclusive ad analytic tool powered by Concert called Creative Intelligence. What this does is allows us to have tools that work for your brands and helps eliminate risk. Exclusive to Vox Media, it's the first of kind in the media industry where we have an optimization tool that is capable of making many decisions with your advertising that don't allow you to sit there and think, oh, I'm gonna go with this headline versus this headline, where we now have a tool that can solve that for you. It basically gives marketers full control of their design ads and brings back the importance of creative excellence in a digital landscape using the power of science to engage the consumer with the best creative as possible. Again, it basically helps eliminate that what if. And creative intelligence makes advertisers more smart. So let me kind of break that down a little bit and actually give you a real example that we used for a campaign. We partnered with Lenovo earlier last year. They're an official laptop sponsor of the NFL in the States. Vox Creative built Fantasy Online College, this fictional online university that pokes fun of fantasy football culture. When we were doing strategy for this campaign, one of the big things is they had 10 NFL stars that were a part of their campaign. They were trying to figure out how many stars should we use in our creative. We went out with one set of creatives that had almost all the athletes in the creative. You couldn't really tell the headline, and they thought it was gonna perform because it had all these NFL stars. We actually saw that ad only perform about 0.04%. through creative intelligence, we're able to quickly optimize this creative and make the headline and image different. We focus then on one or two athletes, made the headline more clear that it was about their favorite athlete or fantasy football, and performance jumped by 10x to 0.4. When you think about that as it relates to your media campaign or impressions that you're buying, we helped eliminate risk right away. When we thought the first strategy was gonna be the home run, it actually wasn't, and we were able to use our technology and data to optimize to use creative that would perform exponentially better. I'll give you one other quick example. There's an NFL athlete called Jamaal Charles. He went down on a Sunday with a season-long injury last year. Jamaal Charles also was the number one pick of fantasy last year, literally everyone's first draft pick. And so when he went down on that Sunday, by Tuesday, the creative that featured him or his name dropped by 8x. And so if a normal campaign would have happened, that creative would have kept running and no one would have engaged with it and it would have been waste impressions that you bought as an advertiser. But our system with creative intelligence was able to real-time optimize by Tuesday to rip Jamaal Charles out of the ads, not remove his content, just focus on a different NFL player that was with him in that content, use the different name of an NFL player and help make that content still perform instead of going with the most predominant NFL player because he's the biggest star. He went down with an injury. Fantasy players are annoyed, and so let's switch it up and make sure that we use a different player to make that creative still perform. Again, eliminating the risk, which is huge for advertisers as you're spending a lot of time and effort to create these beautiful stories with Vox Creative. So at Vox Media, we believe it's time to get smart. I hope today that you've seen how we have. We apply the most data-informed strategies to determine how we develop and distribute the most stunning video and editorial content in this industry. For us, this isn't just the right way to build a meaningful and enduring relationship with your consumer. It's the only way. Now, this whole speech was called Stubbornly Smart. If you've taken any tallies today, I believe I counted it up right before we went on stage. We said it 221 times today. That's because we are obsessed at making sure that not only we are developing content that is smart for our media brands, but also smart for your brands. We hope to have this opportunity to show you how smart we are for your upcoming campaigns, and we thank you for coming today and listening to us, and we wish you the best at the rest of your New Mexico. Thank you all so much. Julie.